In 2008, Gwendolyn Stewart King and her husband, Colbert I. King, both Howard University graduates, donated $1 million to their alma mater to establish the Endowed Chair in Public Policy Lecture Series. Highly accomplished in their own right, the Kings wanted to bring the best and brightest leaders and visionaries face to face with Howard University students to share their wisdom and experience. The result has been an inspiring and motivational series that reflects the Kings' passion for public service. Through the years, their speakers have come from the World Bank, the White House, and many places in between. And today, in partnership with the Rock Newman Show, the tradition continues with U.S. Congressman from Maryland and son of the soil of Howard University, Elijah Cummings. Welcome to the Rock Newman Show. As we get into today's broadcast, there are two housekeeping matters that I'd like to take care of. One, I need to say, although they've already been acknowledged off camera, I want to say on camera how absolutely thrilled I am to be a part of the Gwendolyn S. and Colbert I. King lecture series here at Howard University, the School of Public Policy and the School of Business. They are amongst our guests here today. Thank you so very much, both of you. And the second matter of business is one where we lost one of the giants of our community just hours ago, and that is Mayor for Life of Washington, D.C., Marion S. Barry. If we could take a very quick moment on camera and bow our heads in honor and respect and tribute to the mayor. Thank you. I am absolutely excited about our guest today. I'm going to do something I don't normally do and run down this list at the risk of repeating some of what was already said off camera here. Our guest is Elijah Cummings. He was born January 18, 1951 in Baltimore, Maryland. His parents were Ruth and Robert Cummings. They were sharecropper farmers from South Carolina, both with second grade education. He attends the New Palmas Baptist Church in Baltimore. Graduated from Howard University in 1973 with a BA in political science. Graduated from the University of Maryland School of Law in 1976. He married, we have something very much in common. We both married well above our heads. He married Dr. Maya Rockamore Cummings. He practiced law for 19 years. Before being elected to the Maryland House of Delegates in 1996. He represents Maryland's 7th District in the U.S. House of Representatives, served as chairman of the Congressional Black Caucus during the 108th U.S. Congress, currently has 11 honorary doctorate degrees from universities in the United States, and he currently serves as the ranking member of the Committee on Oversight and Government Reform, where he has to do battle on a regular basis with a gentleman from California named Daryl Issa. And as I was getting my beard trimmed in the barbershop before I came here today, one of them said, ask him, when is he gonna slap Daryl Issa?
Mr. Chairman, you cannot run a committee like this. You just cannot do this. We're better than that as a country. We're better than that as a committee. I have asked for a few minutes to ask a procedural.
I am now the attorney being called. We have adjourned. I don't care. The fact is that I'm asking.
Welcome to the Rock Newman Show.
It's good to be with you.
Thank you so very much.
I'm honored.
I mentioned us losing Marion Barry, and before we get into your storied career and all that's going on in the United States and the rest of the world here today, if I could have maybe a reflection of yours regarding Mayor Barry.
First of all, let me say that I'm honored to be here, and I too thank Gwendolyn and Colbert King for this wonderful opportunity. And it always moves me when people reach back to lift somebody else up, and I thank them. Marion Barry, I met in 1969 as a student here at Howard. As a matter of fact, he
he got us involved in a number of activities, feeding the hungry, doing all kinds of things, and working on campaigns and things of that nature. And so he taught me a lot. And over the years, I've stayed in contact with him. And, you know, I know that people a lot of times will look at negative things that happen to a person and define them by those things. But I got to tell you, Marion Barry was a special person. He was what I call a servant leader, one who gave his blood, his sweat, and his tears to make people's lives better. And I think that when you have somebody like Marion, who not only had the ability to feel the pain of folks, but then to be able to do, to want to do something about it, and then do something about it, very significant. And he made a tremendous contribution. The other thing, when I think about Marion, I cannot help but think about something that was said about Franklin Delano Roosevelt. They said after Roosevelt died, a reporter, they were taking his casket down in, on a carriage down the street and on the way to burial. And a gentleman that was standing on the side of the road just literally fell to his knees and began to cry. And the reporter standing next to him and said, "Sir, you must have known President Roosevelt quite well. I see that you're very emotional." He said, "No, I did not know him, but he knew me." And I think that's what could be said about Marion Barry. He knew the people that he represented, and he gave everything he had.
We sit here at Howard University School of Business today. As we've already mentioned, you are a proud Howard graduate.
Yes, I am.
This is so important to me. Since 1973, when I graduated, I have not missed a Howard graduation. And a lot of times, I don't even know people who are graduating, but I come because I want to see young people emerge into the world to be leaders. And sometimes you just need that good feeling.
First, let me ask you, did you live on campus when you were here?
I sure did. I lived at Carver Hall.
You lived at Carver Hall.
That's right.
I was here three of the 4 years that you were here.
Is that right?
I often saw you leaving Bethune Hall. Let me ask you, if you might travel back, today's theme is really empowering faith and education. If you might take us back to your time at Howard University and what this school meant to you as a young man.
Yeah, probably first it's best to start and talk about the day I got here.
Okay.
And I'd never forget my father dropped me off at Carver Hall. And he said, "Now, boy, you know, me and your mama, we done bought your loggers the way we could." Mm-hmm. And, you know, we couldn't take it but so far, because our education just so limited.
Sure.
But I'm dropping you off here, and they got a lot of professors and really real smart people.
Yeah.
And they're going to take you from here. And then he said some words that I shall never forget. "We brought you here to be blessed, so that you can go out and bless some other people."
Mm-hmm.
And that lives with me every single day. Go out there, be blessed, get the education, but then go out there and take your education and help somebody else. And so Howard meant a lot to me. The first day I got here, they had just gotten some moon rocks. And I was shocked that they would allow black folk they have these moon rocks on the campus.
Mm-hmm.
And I went to see them, and then I began to look around, and I had never seen this many African-American professionals anywhere.
Right.
And I tell you, it blew my mind. And it made me so proud. And then I had an opportunity to be embraced by professors and a fellow named Carl Anderson, who's in our audience today, mm-hmm. Who was the head of students. And
Vice President for Student Affairs.
That's right.
Absolutely.
And he was a mentor and still is a mentor to this day.
Yes, yes.
And people like that, they embraced you and they showed you what you could be and showed me what I could be. And here I was, I had spent special ed, I spent from the kindergarten to the middle of the sixth grade, I'd been in special ed as a child.
Mm-hmm.
And then to come to Howard University and end up a Phi Beta Kappa, well, you know I love Howard.
Yes. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You know, you talk about your dad coming here and you speak sort of in the tone that in which he spoke to you.
Yes.
You wrote a letter to your father
I read that letter. I was filled with pride, and it made me cry. Talk to us about what prompted you to write that letter when you wrote it. It was extraordinarily touching.
Yeah, it was a letter I wanted. It was a Father's Day. I forget what year it was, but it was many years ago. But I had written a letter to my father because I wanted to say to him on Father's Day very openly what he meant to me.
What did he mean to you?
My father, I told him in the letter, I said, you know, you're the wind beneath my wings. He was a man who, he had very, very little with regard to money or whatever, but he was rich in determination. And my father was the type of guy who, when he would come home from working at Bethlehem Steel and Davison Chemical Company, he would literally sit out in the car for an hour. Yeah. I don't care whether it was hot or cold. And then he would come in. And so finally I asked him, well, Dad, why did you do that? Why did you just do that? Because we little kids, we wanted to see our daddy.
Sure.
He said, because they would call me everything but a child of God. Mm-hmm. They gave me the worst jobs. I was breathing chemicals all day. And he said, I did not want to bring that pain upon my family. Mm-hmm. I wish more men would do that today.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then he was a church man. He not only was he a churchman, but he was a man who believed in lifting up women. My mother was a pastor, mm-hmm. and he went with her to lift up her church. And so I had two strong parents. So I saw a man, and I had never, ever heard my father raise his voice to my mother, ever. And he used to bring a Baby Ruth candy bar every Friday when he got paid, every Friday, Baby Ruth. And I was confused as to where he would get these flowers from. He would always bring some flowers, right? Mm-hmm. And come to find out, I said, Daddy, where you get them flowers from you bring Mama every Friday? He said, don't tell nobody. Sometimes I just jump over the graveyard thing and pull one out.
All see right. what I mean? So he was he was creative and resourceful.
Oh, yeah, he was creative now. So when you see that, and you see somebody who constantly tells you that, and one of his favorite sayings, Rock, was there is nothing, he said, the word can't is not in my vocabulary, and I refuse it to let it be in yours.
Yeah, yeah. Obviously, such incredible impact from someone, as you have described, as we read earlier, your parents had second grade education.
Yeah.
And for the students who sit amongst us here today, part of what I wanted to do with this interview is to frame it and put it in the kind of context for you now are a high-ranking member of Congress, but that's not hardly where you started.
No.
You started in an area, again, with parents with second-grade education, but who cared about you and wanted you to be better.
Right.
You experienced something as a youngster that I think would help identify and put in perspective where you come from. And it's something that you wrote about and talked about, the Riverside Pool incident.
Oh, yeah. You know, there are certain incidents that change the trajectory of your destiny. And when I was a little boy, about 10 or 11 years old, we lived in a very poor neighborhood in South Baltimore. And we had a pool that's about the size, about maybe three times the size of the stage here, and a wading pool. And it was about 2 feet deep, maybe 2.5. And there were so many kids, we had to literally wait turns to get into the wading pool in the summertime. So you can imagine what it felt like after about 4 or 5 shifts in the hot sun, and the water wasn't that clean either, but by then. And so the next thing you know, a lady named Juanita Jackson Mitchell, I did not know her, came riding up in a convertible, and come to find out she was with the NAACP. And she said, children, I want y'all, I'm gonna take y'all to a pool. She said, aren't y'all tired of waiting here and don't you want to go to a big pool? And I said, yeah, oh, I love that. And she said, well, there's a pool 12 blocks away. You can, I'm gonna take you there. Now, the thing she did not tell us that it was segregated. And so we walked with the NAACP people, maybe about 150 kids, every day for 7 days.
And we were beaten, stomped, kicked, but we'd get a little further and further each day. And by the seventh day, we were in the pool. And that incident changed my life.
How so?
It changed my life because, first of all, it showed me that there was a better life. That's number one. Number two, it told me that I had rights that people had to respect. Number three, it showed me the power of doing something and going against the grain. And number four, it made me want to be a lawyer because I realized that Ms. Mitchell was a lawyer. And I said, if somebody can do this, can change my life and to change my neighbors' lives like this, and you're a lawyer, that's what I want to be. And so at 11 years old, I determined I want to be a lawyer because I felt that it would provide me with a certain level of power to help other people. And my mother and father were big on helping other people. They believed in giving at the church and cleaning people's houses. And my father, he had the only car in the neighborhood, so he would take people on errands for free and things of that nature. And so they taught us how to give. So I figured that this was a tool that I could use to be able to do what my parents did. Sort of like what my father said, go out there and get blessed so that you can bless.
Absolutely. I want to read a quote that is attributed to you. Young African American men have immense potential to be powerful and inspiring leaders in our communities, but they face challenges both economic and systemic that no other demographic in the United States endures. Yeah. What do you mean?
Well, from a little boy, and another reason I wanted to be a lawyer is I saw so many of my friends go away to reform school as a young boy. I saw, as we here are dealing with the Ferguson issue, I saw Ferguson when I was a little boy. You know, people would come and I'd see on a Saturday morning, the cops would come, and I couldn't have been old, more than six or seven. Cops would come into the alleys, and the men would play dice in the mornings, sure, on Saturday morning, and they were gambling, and the police would come, scatter them, beat them, take their money and leave. That's on Saturday morning. Then Monday morning, they want me to act like I didn't see it when a so-called officer friendly comes to visit. And so I've seen this over and over again. And I was a victim to some degree of the labeling of black boys. I was put in special ed, and they told me I was put in special ed because I talked too much. And you can imagine, I mean, it sounds funny sitting here now, but when you're a little kid, yeah, and somebody said, well, you in this class and you being called dumb and stupid because you talk too much, what does that do? That makes you want to shut up. Yeah. And it makes you not feel too good about yourself. So I think a lot of, and then I look at the whole situation where we have so many young black men who are placed in prison. And I practiced criminal law for many years, placed in prison because of drug offenses. And then I live in the inner city. See, I'm a different kind of congressman. I live in the inner city. So I see what goes on every day. I see young men who are on the way taking their girlfriend to the movies, yeah, and standing at the bus stop, and the police comes and tell them to drop their pants in front of their girlfriend. Right. What does that do, not only for him, but for the girlfriend? So you have two people who have gotten to a certain level of anger towards the police, and rightfully so. So I see there's a lot of that. And then when you put some of our children in some of the worst schools with some of the most least experienced teachers, you got a formula for disaster. And I think that and many other things are affecting so many of our boys. And it becomes almost a miracle that many of them even succeed at all.
On that note, again, keeping with today's theme, part of it being, yeah, faith. What role has faith played in your climb, in your journey, and in your life now?
Well, faith has played a major role in that from as long as I can remember, I can remember back to about 4 years old, maybe four and a half, my mother would have prayer services, and we would have to get up and testify. You know what testifying is?
Oh, I know what testifying is. I had to testify many, many times.
So you get up and testify.
Yeah.
People ask me today, why is it so easy for you to speak in front of large crowds? Mm. Well, I was talking in front of 100 people when I was 4 years old. Mm. And so we would get up and testify.
Do you remember one of those early testimonies?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Talk to us.
Well, I want to thank the Lord for bringing me through the day. I can tell you when I'm five years old. I thank the Lord for bringing me through the day. I thank him for taking me to school. I thank him for Miss Caswell, my good teacher. She's been so good to me. She gave me an extra carton of milk today, gave me an extra graham cracker. Mm-hmm. And I want to thank God for the custodian, Mr. Weeks, mm-hmm. Who let us help him clean up the rooms, yeah. and stuff like that. Yeah. So you would, but you always start off thanking them for your mama and your daddy.
Sure.
You know, so I got used to that. And my mother would take us to church almost like, I'd get her nail, I'd say, you had us in church almost every day. But we would be in church and we would pray to God to save us. So I know all the terms of the Pentecostal church. And my mother was so religious, to this day, my mother has never held a card, you know, like your playing card.
Uh-huh.
I don't even know how to play cards.
Wow.
To this day.
Yeah.
We couldn't dance. My mother has never been to a movie. So we were it was a very strict kind of Pentecostal upbringing. And so, but we always were taught that this God that we serve would create a better life for us. And I'll never forget probably the big God moment in my life is in the sixth grade when I talked to my counselor and I told him I wanted to be a lawyer, and he told me you could never be a lawyer. Mm-hmm. He said, look at your mama and look at your father.
Yeah.
Limited education, you can't be a lawyer, you got six brothers and sisters. Mm-hmm. And I went home to my mother, and I'll never forget it.
Is this someone from your community or a white individual?
No, this was an African-American counselor.
Okay.
Hello.
Mm-hmm.
And my mother, I'll never forget, I can remember it like it was happening right now. She had one of those ringers where you put your clothes through, you know, they didn't have the dryers back
then.
Yeah. And I came home, and my mother, like many mothers, could sense when something was wrong.
Yeah.
When I came in the door, she said, what's wrong? She never looked up. I mm-hmm. said, Ma, the counselor said I could never be a lawyer. And she never looked up. She just kept putting the clothes through the ringer. He said, why did he say that? I said, no, I don't know, Ma. He said, you all didn't go to school that far and everything. She said, you know, there are a lot of educated fools.
Yeah.
And she said, I want you to go out there and be the best that you can be. And God's gonna look out for you, because God's got a special blessing for you. And she said, I want you to do one thing, claim it.
Mm-hmm.
She said, you wanna be a lawyer? You're gonna be a lawyer, claim it.
Mm-hmm.
And so she had me right on the back of a river rice box. We used to say rice all the time. Mm-hmm. I will be who I wanna be. I will be a lawyer. And God is going to allow me to claim it.
Yeah.
I still have that little piece of paper. And she said, she prayed over that piece of paper, and she said, I want you to take this paper everywhere you go, every challenge you have, yeah. I want you to take this piece of paper. And so, today I'm a lawyer. But she believed, and religion, and all throughout, whenever I was down, religion kept me balanced. But it also did something else. It kept me on the straight and narrow. You may stray, but you always come back.
Mm-hmm.
Because you have something to come back to.
A moral compass.
Yeah, you have there you go, mm-hmm. a moral compass. And I tell my mother, I said, Mother, I tell her all the time, my father passed 14 years ago. I said, Mother, one of the greatest things that you and Dad ever did for me was to introduce me to a God who sits high and looks low. Because I realized I would not be where I am today if it were not for you all and introducing me to that God. And so I truly believe that.
Staying right here with our theme of faith for the time, is today's church able to reach younger generations? You were impacted. You were clearly reached, and it made a difference in your life.
Yeah.
What about today?
I think some churches are able to do it. and I think some churches are not. I think a lot of times some churches have gotten so big that they confuse rituals with reality. And I've spoken about this in churches. It's the same when you have a mega church, but yet and still you've got children who are sitting on the front row who cannot read. It's the same when you have folks who don't have scholarship money, but yet and still churches are spending phenomenal sums on various events that don't necessarily uplift people. On the other hand, there are a lot of churches that do a lot of great things. But I think a lot of times young people want to feel that the church is investing something in them. And a lot of times in talking to young people, they in my neighborhood, they don't feel that, that's the case. And they're very critical many times, feeling that the church has become a bit too flashy and not doing enough to uplift their lives.
Churches, when you were growing up in the 60s, in the heart of the civil rights movement,
right.
They came together around social injustices.
Right.
Do you see a parallel in 2014 as we enter into 2015?
I see some of that, but I think we need to. It needs to be more. I believe very firmly that in today's world, you know, when we have something like, for example, the attack on the vote, there should be every single church should be addressing that issue, because that goes to our very existence. That goes to our very ability to participate in this society. And so I think more and more churches need to address those social things, but a lot of them sort of shy away. I hate making a blanket statement, because on the other hand, you've got some churches that do a lot of great things in that regard. But I think all of them should be doing, being involved in social issues. I used to tell my mother, I said, you know, Ma, I know that you all are trying to get to heaven, but I'm worried about being right here on earth.
Yeah.
And how do we live the very best life that we can right here on earth? And so I, as a son of two preachers, I have mixed feelings. But again, I think the church has a phenomenal potential and power. I think the church has played a significant role in the past in bringing about changes, particularly for African-American people, and by the way, and others, white women and so many others, sure, because of civil rights for African-Americans. But I think we can do more.
We are roughly the same age, and we looked at the 60s and the 70s and the 80s and into the 90s with a real sense of enthusiasm and optimism and a sense that life was getting better. The racial divide was closing. The sense of hostility and segregation was dissipating.
Mm-hmm.
And now we have the Tea Party.
Yeah.
And it seems like that sense of coming together has been reversed.
No doubt about it. I have never seen anything like the Tea Party. These folks don't believe in government. They don't believe in government. And you have a group of people who basically say we shouldn't have government, we shouldn't tax. They say that, and they seem to, you know, there have been people who made statements saying the Tea Party is racist. I don't necessarily say that, but I can tell you the kinds of things.
You know, my mom said to me one time, if I'm sorry,
no, that's
all right. Sorry to interrupt you, but at one point she was, she had a thought,
mm-hmm,
and she felt a certain way. And I said, Mom, if you do that, I'm going to get up from this table and leave. And she said, well, I might not say it, but I sure am thinking it.
It's the Tea Party,
when I look at what the Tea Party has done to the Congress, they've basically taken control. Yeah. And I'd say about 50 members, maybe a little bit more, of the House of Representatives. And of course you have them in the Senate. But they basically take the attitude that let's not build infrastructure, let's not worry about colleges, let's not worry about research, let's not worry about the development of our nation and our children. I mean, it's incredible.
What do you think the why is behind that? Why?
You know, I think there's a certain level. We all saw it when the president became president. Yeah. President Barack Obama became president, and I think that by him becoming president, that brought out a lot of negative feelings that were already there. And I think that there is a fear. I think a lot of this is driven by fear that as the population becomes more brown and black, that folks, brown and black people, will take over. And I think these are people who are trying to hold on to power. That's what I believe.
Let's talk about education. Is the push to privatization of our schools, is that a good thing or a bad thing? Somewhere in between.
Well, you know, the thing that I worry about with regard to public education is that I want to make sure that since 95% or more of our children go to public schools, I want to make sure that those schools are properly funded. And when I think about the privatization of education, I see it as a move to pull resources out of the public schools and help a few folks. And that's good. I mean, I think it's important for everybody to succeed. But when you're doing it, Rock, at the expense of the 95%, that's a problem. See, I literally run a school. I run I'm like the chairman of the board of a school in Baltimore. We have about 450 kids. It's called the Maritime Academy. And I have been the chairman of the board. This is something I do as a volunteer. I am the chairman. And I've run this school now for 8 or 9 years. But Rock, when I see the resources that these kids get, I know that they are being shortchanged. I know it. And the other thing that's so painful that I see with these kids is that the public education that they're getting, by the time I get them in the ninth grade, I say 80% of them cannot read past the third grade level.
How do we address that?
We got to go back to elementary school. We got to go back to elementary schools and pre-K. By the way, that's basically what we do. In my school, we've gotten private industry because it's a maritime academy. It deals with the maritime industry wanting to pull people into the maritime types of businesses. And so what they do is they give money to the school. And they give money to the school now mainly for remediation. For remediation, so that we can at least educate our kids enough so that they can even appreciate the maritime education and the maritime opportunities. In the maritime area, I can get a kid, if they come through high school, we can have them a $40,000 job the minute they graduate from high school. 40,000 automatic, and that's up to about 70 or 80 within, I say, 4 or 5 years.
So those who are on the other side of the aisle in Congress, do you prescribe to the theory that these rollbacks are intentional to hurt those who don't look like them?
You know, I'm not sure. I think it's more of a selfishness. See, because what's happening is we're taxing the rich less. Are you following me?
Yes.
So I don't necessarily that I'm trying to hurt somebody, that they're trying to hurt somebody. I think it's more like I want to make sure that the people who give to my campaign and the people who who support me, I'm going to make sure that they get theirs. But in the process, what happens is that resources are being taken away.
And it's just not schools, by the way. It's infrastructure. It's the very fabric of our society. It's research and development. It's NIH. And that's why it's so significant. We got to really watch this thing about money being able to buy elections.
That's what I was saying. I don't want to get ahead of myself and stay a little bit further with education, but that sounds so much like government for sale.
Yeah. Oh, but that's basically what it is. You know? Do you know that we have a fellow in the Congress, African American, named Horsford. He's from
Stephen Horsford.
One of the best. Yes. One of the most brilliant members I have ever met.
Yeah.
He's just finished his first year. Yeah. He lost his election. You know why? He lost his election because folks came in, plopped down $2 or $3 million in his district in about a week or two, brought up the air, and they defeated him. It's the only member of the Congressional Black Caucus that lost. And I can see that happening over and over and over again. Emmanuel Cleaver just told us he won his another African-American member of the caucus. He won his election 51%. He said he knows, he has absolutely no doubt, he'll be the last African-American to represent his district.
Okay, since we're there.
And that's largely, a lot of that is because of money.
Where is the remedy?
The remedy is...
Because Citizens United, Koch Brothers...
Supreme Court,
how are we going to fix that? Because it appears... Mm-hmm. As if we're headed towards an oligarchy.
No doubt, there's absolutely no doubt about that. And when you say that, a lot of people hear you and say, "Oh, come on."
Yeah, right.
But you're right.
Yeah.
I think what we do is we've got Congressman Sarbanes from Maryland, a good friend of mine, has been pushing this effort to try to make elections more like public elections, where the public can actually pay for their own elections. One of the pay for the elections, in other words, with a tax deduction or whatever. But the problem is that a lot of times people don't vote now, Rock, because they feel as if the game has already been rigged. And they say to themselves, what difference does it make if I vote? Because the votes have already been bought. And then they don't want to come out because they say, you know, it's one thing for me to vote and not know the game is rigged. Yeah. But if I know the game is rigged, I'm just not going there. And I've heard that over and over and over again. I hear it in my neighborhood, which is, like I said, is in the inner city. And they are wise. They get it.
That's depressing. That's depressing. And I would ask, as we sit before students from the middle school at Howard University and Howard University students, so why should they be hopeful?
They should be hopeful because they still have the power to vote. They should be hopeful because they are getting an education that will empower them to go out there and make a difference. And they can make a difference. And as I was telling the crowd yesterday here on Howard's campus, you know, Rock, in 30 years or less, I'll be dead. And I want to make sure that they are empowered to go out there and make a difference, to go out there and be the leaders. And sometimes you want to wait for somebody to bring about change. You got to be the change. You have to do it yourself. And I want them to be equipped with the knowledge. And being here at Howard University is major, because we do produce leaders here. And so I think it's that leadership that has to go out there, have to encourage people. And you got to, by the way, you have to continue to vote, no matter what. But then try to change the dynamics so that you have a different Supreme Court, so that you have different legislators who will take this whole thing of government very seriously, and who won't just say government does not matter, because government does.
There's mass incarceration of black men throughout the United States. Is that about justice, or is it about big business?
I think a lot of it is about big business. Because keep in mind, we've got probably more prisoners in prison than any country, and per capita, there's no doubt about it. And a lot of these folks are in there, and they are in there for drug offenses and nonviolent drug offenses. And then when we look at the how they got there, it's clear that white folks use just as much drugs as black folks, if not much more. But yet and still, the enforcement on that side is one thing. The enforcement in the streets of my neighborhood are a whole nother thing. And so that, so, and it's big money. It's big money. But guess what's happening now, Rob? What is happening now is there are more and more Republican legislators joining in with people like Congressman Bobby Scott from Virginia and others who are saying, you know, let's decriminalize some of these drug offenses so that we don't have as many people going to jail. And you know why they're doing it? Because of money. Because of money. They don't want to spend as much taxpayers' dollars on the prisons. They want to spend it for something else. So again,
speaking of spending taxpayers' dollars, we continue to see the militarization of police.
Yes, we saw it in Ferguson.
Putting more and more money into prisons and an attempt to abolish the Department of Education and defund programs for education.
That's right, and that's why, again, you've got to have people. I tell folks all the time, leadership matters. Who's calling the shot matters. And you've got to have people who are sensitive to these issues trying to address these issues. And that's why the people that sit in this room are the folks who can make that difference, but they've got to be prepared to go out there and do it.
We mentioned just briefly Ferguson. The St. Louis, the greater St. Louis area is on edge. Frankly, the country is on edge. We read last night, 10 or 12 year old kid gets shot dead. He had a play BB gun. The 911 call informed the dispatcher that there was a kid. It seemed as if he had a play BB gun. He dies. The dispatcher supposedly, allegedly did not tell the police officer that the people who called said it was a play gun. So how can the citizens in Washington, D.C. and other of our communities prepare ourselves to fight against the proliferation of a loss of life of oftentimes innocent black men to the police state?
You know, first of all, when I look at Ferguson, and I see what happened there, but there are Fergusons everywhere. There are Ferguson-type incidents in Baltimore. And I think that we have to figure out ways. I've been involved in several forums where we have police officers actually come in and talk to young people. Some kind of way we've got to make police understand that every life is a very valuable life, and that they don't have to have a military force in our neighborhoods. But you gotta understand something else, Rock, that happens. You've got a lot of African American people who, in some instances, ask for certain types of protection in their neighborhoods. Because I've been to the town hall meetings and listened to this. So we gotta have a balance. You've gotta have a police force that actually works with the neighborhood, gets to know them. One of the reasons why I've always encouraged policemen to attend churches in black neighborhoods or whatever, so that they can see something other than what they see on the 6 o'clock news. I want them to see people who, like my father, people who are working hard, trying to make a difference. And then there needs to be an interaction. Because let me tell you what happens. When you don't have a relationship with the community, it's almost impossible to get a conviction because the community is not going to convict. I've seen it many times. Somebody can come and shoot you in your head. We got 20 people watch it. And the person who did it gets off. Or You get no cooperation from the public. 20 people see somebody do it, and nobody tells. Why? Because they are intimidated. We've got to figure out ways to get past this. The thing that I worry about with regard to Ferguson is that the way that they had built this thing up already, state of emergency weeks before the decision even comes down, it's almost like you're inviting people to do something. And when 99% of the people who protest were protesting peacefully, and people ought to be able to protest peacefully. But that's why I went back. I talked about what I said earlier in this interview about my relationship with the police. I've seen it. I see all of it. I see the negative, but I've also seen some positive. But we've got to do better. And as far as the Ferguson decision, I think that the jury, if the grand jury were to come back and not indict this police officer, I think we have to protest, but we have to be very careful, because I don't want people. I don't want a situation where we then have policemen going against the public, and then more of those kinds of incidents happen. I also think we need to look more towards the federal government. Hopefully, their investigation will bring out more and address this thing in a way where the public feels comfortable that whatever decision is made is an appropriate decision, because a lot of this is about trust. So we still have a long way to go.
And it's a powder keg.
Without a doubt.
And I mean, I think people who care have good reason to be nervous.
We have good reason, but Rock, you cannot have this discussion without also addressing the issue of black-on-black crime. As you know, I had a nephew that went the way to school at the Old Dominion and was killed 5 o'clock in the morning. And the next day I went to see his brains splattered all over the wall. Why? Because of some jealousy of the guys in the neighborhood to the kids who were at the college. And so, you know, there's a lot here. And at the bottom of a lot of the things, I was in my neighborhood the other day, and I was looking around, and I was saying to myself, if you don't have a job, you don't have money, you don't have an education, then you have the likelihood that a people will feed on itself. And I see that. And so these are the kinds of issues that I grapple with every day. Yeah. And they're not easy.
2008, Barack Hussein Obama elected president. People started talking about a post-racial society. I don't even have to ask that question, because we know that's not the case. Has the presidency of Barack Hussein Obama realized the hopes and dreams and aspiration of black people, or has it fallen far short?
I think it's realized the hopes and dreams in this sense, that there were many of us that never dreamed that a man of color would reach that height. But I think that, on the other hand, when he became president, we saw some of the most vicious and many of them based on race actions against him that we've ever seen. And I know, because I serve as the ranking member of the Oversight Committee that does the investigations, and I can tell you of the president, and I can tell you, you may hear about 5% of what he has to deal with.
Can you give us an example?
Subpoenas flying all over the place. I mean, there's almost, I cannot think of one agency where there are not somebody. Let me give you, this is the way it usually works. You talked about Chairman Issa a little earlier. You may have somebody who's a career employee, let's say working at HUD. They see a email that comes across their desk that makes it looks like, well, maybe there's maybe something here going on. Maybe somebody close to the president did something. So then what Mr. Issa does is that he subpoenas all the records, all the emails, for maybe a year before and a year after. Yeah. You follow what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And so what that does is that that ties up the people that work on my staff. They've got to go through all these emails. I mean, you may have hundreds of thousands. And so we've got almost every agency in some way or another being tied up like that. IRS spent $17 million in a matter of less than a year just trying to pull emails because of subpoenas coming out of our committees. And then it's an effort to then try to embarrass the president. And so this president has gone through, first of all, he's had one of the most difficult presidencies in that he's had to deal with some of the most difficult issues. And then not only has he had to deal with some of the most difficult issues, he had absolutely no support. As a matter of fact, he had maximum opposition from the Republicans. I wish they would just stand out the way and let him do his job. And so he's really gone through a lot. So this is the piece where I think a lot of folks get frustrated. They saw the president come in, good government, transparent government. We're going to do this thing. We're going to do it well. We'll do it right. You had a lot of young people that got involved because they were excited. Finally, we can throw away elections being bought and all this kind of thing. And the next thing you know, they discovered that he was not able to achieve the things that he said he would achieve. And then there have been some things when folks look at the drones and they look at things, other things that have happened, like the NSA. They look at all of these things and they say, well, wait a minute. You know, I thought you said you were going to do away with these. But I can tell you that I don't know too many people who would want to be president because there's so much to it. There's so many, and you cannot say why he made this decision or that decision, but I can tell you in talking to people, I know a lot of young people feel a certain level of disappointment. Then there's another piece that happened, and that is that he, while he was able to do a lot with regard to addressing the recession and bringing back jobs, a lot of folks still, particularly African Americans, are still not feeling it because of income inequality. You've got these companies that are making a whole lot of money and paying employees less and less. And so they're not feeling it. And so all of those things, I think, give a feeling of disappointment. They feel, a lot of people may feel let down. And you can tell them all you want that the Affordable Care Act passed and now you've got health insurance. But if they don't have money in their pocket, it's kind of rough. And that's real.
What's Elijah Cummings' priority as you enter into the new year? What's your political priority?
What I really want to do is try to help this president, first of all, finish these 2 years and try to help him to get jobs into our communities. That's number one. Because let me tell you, Rocky, if you don't have a job, it's not very much you can do. My first priority when he first came in was to get the health insurance done. We got that done. And it's here to stay. They're going to try to tweak with
in
it.
In spite of the lawsuit? Yeah,
no matter what, it's going to be here. It's going to be here, and it's very, very important. But right now, it's jobs. And the other thing that, and I'm still concerned, I have some individual issues that I'm concerned about, like generic drugs. You know, that here recently, companies have taken advantage of the sick. And now they're hiking up the prices of generic drugs, sometimes 4,000 times overnight. Mm-hmm. So we're looking into things like that, where the system is just basically rigged against a lot of people. Then we're also looking into the whole thing of foreclosures, where we're having the big settlements, right? But the very people who were hurt never get any of the money. Mm-hmm. You know, they've suffered, but they don't get the money. So I've been working with Elizabeth Warren and few others to try to make a difference.
Some might say that this question might accuse me of courting love from the students here at Howard University, and they would be right. What are we going to do about student debt and these student loans?
Well, I'm telling you, that is something that's very important to me. By the way, I have a daughter here at Howard, who's a junior. We've been trying to work on a piece of legislation to figure out a way to get those interest rates reduced as much as we can. You know, we had I don't know if you know about the student plus loan.
Yes.
Where we had a big problem with that. We were able to get that remedy to some degree. And we had to really argue with the president on that one. But the Congressional Black Caucus did quite a bit, and it's a lot better now. But we're going to just keep fighting, because I think, I can tell you, the Congressional Black Caucus has the student loan situation very much in our sights, trying to figure out how do we shrink it. Of course, we'd love to increase the Pell Grants, but that's this Tea Party group that we talked about.
Yeah.
That's the last thing they want to see. And so that's where we are.
Elijah, we have, we've got about 75 seconds left here. Mm-hmm. So I'll give you an opportunity to speak to these wonderful students who packed this auditorium here today. The floor is yours, and you will have the last word.
I've often said that our children are the living messages we send to a future we will never see. Little did I think that 45 years from the day that I came on this campus, that I would return here as a lawyer and somebody high in government, and even to be honored to be a part of this Gwendolyn and Kobe King chair. And I just want you to know that time passes very quickly, and you must seize the moment. You must seize the moment. And I hope you'll remember what my father said to me. Those very, very simple words. I need you to go out there and get blessed so that you can be blessed. And one other thing he said to me, he says, you do not have the right. You don't have the right not to be the best that you can be, because so many other people have paid the price. And so I'm honored to be a Howard graduate, and I'm honored to have my daughters, well, one already a Howard graduate and one soon to be. She better be.
A very wise man once told me, know when to shut up. You have the last word, and that wraps us for the day. Thank you very much.
Thank you.